Thank you for inviting me. It's always a pleasure to talk about conservation to bright young students who come from a different domain. Let me first define nature conservation first, because that's my area of expertise. It forms within the bandwidth of sustainability an important component. Nature conservation is not about feeding domestic dogs in Bangalore. It is not about having millions of cows running over the country chewing up. It values wild nature, wild plants, wild animals, and wild landscapes. So, and that includes the processes that go on between these species and the interactions. So nature conservation is not about individual animals. It tends to be about populations. So there is a common myth that it's about being kind to an individual animal or feeding among. It is about maintaining the diversity of life on Earth and the processes. So it focuses on species and populations. Second thing is, often we don't see conservation as anything other than just protection. It is true that because of species are endangered, a large part of conservation in contexts like India has to be about preservation of the biodiversity, wild plants and animals. But there are two other pieces which I'll briefly mention, which are also genuinely a part of wildlife conservation. One is, in some contexts, using wild plants and animals for human use in a sustainable manner also is conservation. Fisheries is a good example of. In some cases, when a particular species of mosquito or a man-eating tiger or something damages human interest, eliminating that damage is also a part of conservation. So wildlife conservation is not about just being in love with nature. It is about doing things in a practical manner so that nature survives in a sustainable way along with human beings. So these are some basic definitions, because I see a lot of confusion. Particularly in the popular media on these basic definitions. Environmental sustainability is a bigger issue. Environmentalism is about making the earth a better place for one species, us, human beings. Conservation is its focus, although it's a part of the overall sustainability goal, its goal, primary goal, is to make sure while we make the world a better place for ourselves, we don't lose the other species. In the game. So a conservationist focus is about other species, whereas environmentalists look at a broader picture of a world in which humans live happily with other things. So these are some basic issues that we need to know. And when we look at wild nature, I'll give primarily Indian examples and primarily in terms of protection. What are the proximate threats? People talk about climate change as a threat, and it's certainly a threat in some cases. For example, the polar bear, the ice caps are receding. In the context of many other contexts, including India, there are more proximate threats that we should not lose sight of. I'm not saying climate change is not a threat to conservation. It perhaps offers both opportunities also, because as the landscapes change, species adapt to them, but certainly hunting and overuse by humans is the biggest threat to nature conservation in India. And this overuse happens in terms of illegal hunting, particularly market-driven illegal hunting. It happens in terms of overuse of biomass, both by rural communities and others. And it includes the massive impact on wild nature that domestic animals have. We have domesticated dogs and cats and horses and donkeys in the last 10,000 years, and their numbers are enormous now. So they are adding to the pressure on wild nature. We often don't realize these trade-offs we have to make if we have to save wild nature. So given that, given this level of pressure, etc., how do we accommodate human aspirations with nature conservation? This really is going to be the key topic or the focus around which I'm going to talk. The conservation movement is approximately 100 years old. And the initial people who set up nature reserves like Kruger or Yosemite or our own Corbett National Park in 1936, they were hunters and they were nature lovers and they wanted. But over time, as the environmental agenda emerged in the 80s, we realized that the whole world is developing. Human aspirations for technology and better lives are pushing the development. And we have to balance the two. Unfortunately, in the early stages of the unrolling of the world conservation strategy and other these big documents, people started confounding conservation with development. My point is the two are very different and sometimes contradictory. Sometimes they can be complementary if you are smart. They are not the same. And by using terms like sustainable development, many of the development people and some of the conservationists too started confounding the two. These are two different things. So there was a debate about this in the early 90s. And an alternative was proposed by one of the preeminent thinkers in conservation in the world today, Dr. John Robinson. He said, unless we resolve this contradiction, unless we have these definitions clear, we will not succeed in saving wild nature. So he proposed an alternative called sustainable landscapes. We have to manage large chunks of land, reserving for one or the other of these activities. So some parts of the landscape has to be strictly protected, as in the case of nature reserves or species that require total protection from human pressures. In some other cases, we do need to keep aside land for rapid industrial growth, generation of energy, mining, whatever that is needed, that needs to be produced. We have to keep in mind that Earth's population is going to hit 10 billion before it starts coming down in 2050. Our own population will stabilize at 1.5 billion or something around that period. So we do need to meet human beings. So the sustainable landscape idea is you do these things in different ways, in a well-knit, intelligent way, but you don't say that you will use nature everywhere in a sustainable manner. That's simply not possible because some forms of biodiversity will just drop out if you try for that unrealistic goal. So this is really important. How do we reconcile conservation and development? So the sustainable landscapes idea means in the context of India, we have to look, we have 3.2 million square kilometers of area in the country. Today, reasonably intact nature occupies less than 10% of that. And if you look at land that is designated for nature conservation, which is primarily the protected areas like national parks and wildlife sanctuaries, they barely cover 4% of the land. So the question of sustainably using these is, to my mind, a ridiculous proportion. A country of 1.3 billion people, depending on this 4% for exploiting this for further material gains, is a no-win solution. Whatever we have left will go. So our goal under the sustainable landscape framework should be to push up to the extent we can, this minuscule 4% wider. So how do we go about doing that is really the question, is really the challenge, because it's not going to be easy. Because I have seen people argue, many people argue, or many conservationists argue, I'm somewhat an odd fish in the conservation community, because many of my colleagues in the conservation movement, particularly those deep scientific training, think that rolling back the clock, winding the clock back, going back to some past century, rejecting technology, rejecting science, and seeking solutions in the past, because in the past everything was wonderful, this is an attitude many people are promoting or advocating. I most emphatically disagree, because there are no solutions to this problem in the past. Because in the past, we did not have 1.5 billion people. We had a life expectancy of 20 or 30 years. Even when I was born in 1948, life expectancy in India was 32 years or something. infant mortality, many things kept human populations in check. Endemic starvation. In 1965, when I was in engineering school in NITK Suratkal, there were food riots in Karnataka. One third the wheat import from of production of Kansas was imported to feed people starving in Bihar. So we do not have solutions in the past by romanticizing the past and saying everything was wonderful. We have pieces of solutions, intelligent use of nature in some cases, but wholesale rolling back the clock is not the solution. We have to embrace science, we have to embrace technology, and we have to apply it to the task of giving people a better life without losing the biodiversity that we are trying to protect. To me, that is really the key. Because I have seen, I'm 72 now, in my life I have passed through different stages. I have been a farmer, I have sold tractors, and I have trained myself to be an ecologist later. So I have seen the spectrum of life, I have seen the country unfold, and any attempt to preach to poor people who are aspiring to come out of poverty and improve their livelihood, to preach that poverty is a virtue or deprivation or lack of material access is a virtue, I think it's a futile exercise. I think it has no takers. If I can briefly say, at least three examples. Gandhiji preached this philosophy, and although we revere him, on the whole, there are absolutely no takers. And in 1965, after rapid industrial growth and its, under a somewhat more brutal, undemocratic model, Mao tried to do the same thing. Simplify everything, go back to a humbler lifestyle and less consumption. It failed. And my own generation, so people who are called baby boomers in the US, also were, talking about long hair, living in commune, shunning everything except your guitar. And that's turned into a business now, and it doesn't exist as a lifestyle. So this rejecting technology, I don't see as takers. And every election in a democratic country like India, the will of the people has been towards growth. So this really is our challenge. We do need to have economic growth. We have to have development. But we do need to keep this 5% or 10% safe and protected. So which means we have to move forward. Two things that will hugely impact wildlife. One is certainly protection. Given the commercial pressure on wildlife trade, even species like pangolins are being marketed and sold, sharks are being harvested. Given this, we do need enforcement. There is no way you can convince people who are determined to destroy wildlife for commercial reasons that you can all convince them to give up their bad ways. You do need law enforcement. You need to recognize that our protected areas are not meant for used by people, particularly when it gets market linked. When there's a forest product that's being stripped bare because there's a global market for it, it stops being sustainable. So we do need to preserve it, which means our land use outside has to change. We do need to rely on efficient agriculture. We have tapped out all the major hydro sites, and the solutions have to come from efficient agriculture through biotechnology. I was very pleased, two women won Nobel Prize in Chemistry for CRISPR. And every paper in India talked about CRISPR benefits of medicine and health. Its application in agriculture is enormous. We need to design plants that can live without water, live without pesticides. All this is within the realm of possibility. Abundant energy is another solution. We clearly need, if people have to be better off, you need more energy. But many of the green energy solutions that are being proposed for India are extremely harmful for wildlife. Whether it is microhydral projects that are being blocking every stream in the Western Ghats, whether it's wind power schemes that are devastating desert habitats of bustards, or solar panels doing the same thing in other places. And they don't even meet the base load. So if we pursue some of these green ideas because they work for someone else in some other context, in a densely populated country like India, we are going to lose a lot of biodiversity. So we, and there is a reckoning coming our way. People are realizing this. And James Lovelock, who enlightened the world about global warming with his Gaia hypothesis, is actually a strong votary of modern technology of these kinds, so that we can save Mother Nature. Right. The last point I want to make is that there is too much gloom and doom and pessimism in the environment. All about saying everything is going, what can we do? We can do nothing. On the other hand, in my own experience, when I was growing up in the 1950s, there were less than 70 tigers in the Western Ghats, Malnad land. There are more than 400 now. Average wage of a human being, man working in the field was 3 rupees per day. It is 600, 700 rupees today. There has been economic growth. There has been a quadrupling of the human population density. And even with the imperfect measures, we have been able to recover nature in some places. We have new tools coming our way, disposable income, a strong middle class that wants nature and values nature. Right now, they're going and trashing protection. We can expand the farming areas, rewild them so that the farmer's income comes from wildlife rather than from some traditional crop. There are many, many innovative solutions. Talk is too brief to kind of cover all of them, but you have to be an optimist to protect nature. You have to embrace and manage technology intelligently. You have to look forward and not back. That's basically in the 22nd century.